Hi. I want to talk about happiness, so something a little bit different, and really the X in UX, experience. My work has been on how do we measure, I'm a statistician, how do we measure tricky things like people's experience of their quality of life? I mainly worked in my career in think tanks, the New Economics Foundation, if any of you know it. I founded the work there on well-being. Probably we're best known for Happy Planet Index. I've done a TED talk on that, if you like TED talks. But I'm going to talk today more about happiness itself, how it works in the organism, and how we can think about that from your perspective in senses about how do we create interventions in that space, and how can you think about designing happiness, the science of happiness, into your work a little bit. I'm not an expert on UX. I have a couple of colleagues. One colleague here is much more, and my business partner is, but I'm more the person that understands a bit about happiness. Many of you will know that Bob Dylan just won the Nobel Prize. I wish it had been Leonard Cohen myself. I'd have preferred it was Leonard Cohen. But I'm really into poetry. I think that poetry can really move us and can talk to us in different ways. And this guy is called David White, and he is actually a corporate poet. He wrote a book called The Soul of the American Corporation. And this is a brief couplet from a poem he wrote called Working Together, which is that we shape ourselves to fit this world, and by the world are shaped again. You know, all of us, none of us is an island. We're not, as an organism, we are very social. We're very interconnected with other people. If I had been born 100 years ago, I would be a different Nick than I am today. You know, modern society shapes me. I try and fit into modern society, sometimes reluctantly. Sometimes we're in systems not exactly of our own choosing, and we have to adapt to them. Our organizations can sometimes be a bit brutal. Our families can be sometimes a bit brutal. Sometimes they can be very loving and nurturing, and we experience that difference about moving between contexts. And so whilst, you know, happiness often resides in the individual, there's always a context to our experiences. And I imagine that lots of you build contexts for people to experience whatever it is you're building. And so we have to be kind of aware of that. But let's think about happiness, yeah? What it is. So here is a picture of a happy guy. He happens to be one of my very best friends. He's called Pete. And someone once started a hashtag Happy Pete at one of my talks. And we can see him smiling. We can see the wrinkles around his eyes glistening, his teeth, his mouth slightly open, his teeth showing. And he's showing what's classically called a Duchenne smile. It's a very authentic happiness smile. We can do the Pan Am smile, it's called, you know, where you sort of try and be, as you know, a stewardess on a flight and you smile. And you can even do a trick where you put a pencil in your mouth and it actually makes the corners of your mouth turn up. And it sort of, in some ways it gets you in a bit more of a positive mood, but it's sort of a bit fake it till you make it sort of stuff. But authenticity of a smile, we're exquisite at reading people's faces. We have about 47, 48 muscles in our faces. And we've evolved to be really able to read these signals. In fact, reading a quote just this week from Barbara Fredrickson, who's a really good positive psychologist, and she said that happiness is not individual. We broadcast our emotions to the world. We communicate them. We see them on people's faces. But as you can see, all of you recognize, I'm sure you recognize happiness when you see it. And happiness forms one of what psychologists sometimes call primary emotions. And I don't want you to overthink about this model. It's a model, it's not the truth. Models are always models, they're not the truth. But you know, when we think about primary emotions, we think about things like fear and anger, sadness, happiness. And if any of you saw this movie, any of you see Inside Out, yeah? Took your kids to it. Some of you might be in the in-between age where you didn't have young kids to take to when you're not quite young enough to go yourself, but it was good Pixar film, really. Quite different for Pixar. In a sense, like Up, when you see Up at the beginning, there's this very emotional passage in Up, which is like, will kids sit through that? And they did. I think Inside Out took that to a completely new level of not so much happening in the film, but a lot of emotion in it. But it was about the primary emotions. In fact, Paul Ekman, who's a psychologist who published a lot on primary emotions and the facial expressions of them across virtually every culture in the world, this is very close to his set. And he was actually an advisor to Pixar. They do get their science pretty right. And so they had anger, fear, joy, disgust, and sadness as these sort of figures living in this girl Riley's head and how they were effectively shaping the way that she interacted with the world. And that is a lot how emotions work. They are really built upon an ancient stimulus response mechanism in the organism. You know, an amoeba will move according to what's happening in the environment, and our emotions help us do that. So fear is about a signal that something is a threat to us. How do we respond to that? You know, do we freeze, and hope the predator doesn't notice us? Do we run away? Do we gather together with other people to protect ourselves? These are all functional, highly functional responses to a so-called negative emotion, a negative emotion being one that has a threat involved in it, yeah? Anger is about response to someone who oversteps a norm, a mark for us, an injustice. We feel angry when we're unjust, and it's a hot emotion. You know, do we fight? Do we fight with words? Do we build an argument against this? Whatever it is. So anger is highly functional. They're part of the fight and flight mechanism. Disgust is a reject emotion. And in fact, I have three kids. They're all quite grown up now, but I have boy, girl, boy. And the two boys, if any of you got two boys, they fight. If you've got a brother, or you had a brother, you probably wrestled a lot when you were young, and there's this play fighting that goes on. And Martha would sometimes, not of her own choosing, get involved in these fights, and she wasn't really very happy about it. And she tried a few strategies. She started crying to mum and dad, shouting, biting was involved sometimes. But eventually she got the right strategy, which was that she licked them. And she immediately stimulated their disgust mechanism, and they were off, And it still, they're 22, 21, and 17, and it will still happen sometimes. And just in the summer this time, I saw her lick them to get rid of them the other day, And it's like it works very effectively. But the story of of Inside Out is a journey between joy and sadness. And this is not an accident. These two emotions are interconnected. Our poets, to go back to poetry again, Cahill Gibran will talk about how our sorrow, this is in The Prophet. If any of you don't know The Prophet, you should read it, particularly if you've got children. Beautiful passage on children there. But he talks about joy and sorrow and about how sorrow is our joy remembered. And about how sorrow carves out space for joy to fill. And, sadness, and in the story with Riley, is actually where she gets to, is to understand the functionality of sadness. That sadness is about, a connection to other people, about a connection to things that we care about. And they're highly, highly interconnected. So these emotions form part of a system inside ourselves which are highly functional in the world, whether they are negative or positive. So when I talk about happiness, I don't want you to think that I don't value fear, anger, sadness, other more difficult emotions, more uncomfortable sometimes to experience. Though sometimes I can enjoy being angry, but that's a bit perverse probably. But if we go back to happiness, the reason Pete was happy was because he was with me. And in a sense, this context to happiness is really, really important. And so you're all laughing now, yeah? If you were just on your own and you were laughing, you'd look slightly mad, yeah? Whereas when you laugh with another human being, it's exceptionally normal and natural. In fact, there is this theory about laughter that, when we were primates, well, we still are primates, we do a lot of grooming. Our mothers would have touched us and felt us, stroked us. It's why intimate relationships, touch is really, really lovely. And I'm thinking about my partner now, but it's like, but that you can only do that with one other person, really. Some people might try it in bigger groups, but I've never done that. But laughter is something we do together, and it is a very positive, stroking thing to laugh with other people. So it became a way that human beings worked in groups together. Laughter became hugely important. And in a sense, this is a clue to how happiness is so social. That we're much more likely to be happy with other people, particularly that sort of higher emotional happiness. We have different types of happiness. We certainly have a more contented, a more meaningful, a lower energy, more reflective form of happiness. and we have a sort of more pleasure. There's a big talk in the literature and in the world, really, about the tension between pleasure and meaning. That, you know, that they're both important to us. You know, if you have a life that is just pleasure with no meaning, it sort of feels a bit shallow. There's periods of our lives where that's quite good fun. If you just have meaning and no pleasure, it's really dry, yeah? And I think we know people that move into those camps. There's some dynamic that goes on there. You know, if you're in a marriage that you really value, but you're deeply unhappy in it, eventually the pleasure signal will start to get you to move, you know, either to make the marriage better or to not. You know, if you're in a relationship that's just purely fun but doesn't really feel like it's going anywhere, you can move out of those. So these things move between us. So in the workplace, and, you know, a lot of people will be using your products and tools. I don't know whether you're B2B or B2C or whatever like that, but people will be using it. You know, you don't want a user to look like this. You know, you don't want someone to be thoroughly miserable, and you don't want to be miserable in work, you know, to pick up from where Jenny is, you know, is that miserable people do miserable work. If you create miserable products, you know, your people are not going to get great outcomes out of them. You know, and we really want to shift towards people being happier, being more fulfilled. I would say that anyway. There may be some people that disagree with me, but I would say that leading a good life, and I really do mean about the pleasure and meaning part of it. I don't mean just pleasure orientated. I do think meaning is hugely important. But leading a life that is fulfilling, I think, should be a goal for all of us. And work is part of that. It's actually the second largest activity that you do in terms of time in your life. So the first is sleeping. The second is work. The third, who wants to guess what the third is? Watching TV, you know, yeah? TV watching is. So if anyone says to you they haven't got the time, ask them how much TV they watch, okay? Because that is where slack time is in this world. TV is very passive. If you do brain scans of people watching TV, it's quite like depression, because it's just sweeping over you. Of course, some TV is fantastic, and I'm not saying you shouldn't have any fun with TV, but actually thinking about going back to work, you know, actually enjoying your work is a hugely important thing in life. And for organizations to be functional, they need high-performing but also happy teams, teams that get on well. You know, that happiness, that positivity is the way that we create bonds and bridges with other people. We form relationships, you know. For those of you that are lucky enough to be in a good, functional, loving relationship, you probably will have met your partner when you're in a good mood. Unlikely that you were angry and terrified when you met your partner. Though there is some exceptions to that. If you go parachute jumping, apparently a lot of women who go parachute jumping fall in love with the instructor because they make them feel safe. But mainly we're going to have created a positive mood around us because, you know, we just are much more attractive when we're happy than when we're grumpy. People will come towards you. We seek out the light. We seek out the warmth of people. If you work with someone that is what I call a radiator, you know, you go to them when you're down and you actually go to them. If someone is a drain, you know, and they're sucking the life out of you, you avoid them, yeah? And they might be brilliant. And the world does have some brilliant jerks, yeah? But I don't want to work with them. And I don't want them working in my company. So creating happy, high-performing teams is really the critical aim. But of course, the thing becomes, how do we become happier? Can we do that? Is it just a genetic thing? It's definitely a genetic component. Definitely a genetic component to our display, particularly of positive emotions. I don't know any research on meaningful lives and genetics. There may be a connection there, I don't know. But in my previous incarnation in New Economics Foundation, we did a big bit of work for the Government Office of Science's Foresight Project. On what was called the five ways to well-being, what became called that. And the inspiration for this was literally five fruit and vegetables a day. We were actually doing a measurement project with them, and I was delivering the results, and there was a bowl of fruit in the middle of the table. And I said to the head of Foresight, I said, we really need the equivalent of five fruit and vegetables for well-being. And he looked at me and he said, we do. Actually, my budget's closed at the end of this week, and I still got £10,000 in there. If you can give me a project for less than £10,000 by the end of the week, you can do a project on this. So he got one for £9,600 on Thursday. And me and Jody, who's in the audience here, because Jody worked with me at NEF as well as at Happiness Works where I am now, we started to work on what were the five big things, what was the evidence for five things you can do in your life to make yourself happier. So I'm going to share these with you. I'm not a designer. I mean, this is design, so I suppose I am a designer. And I suppose I design statistical interventions, so I am a designer, yeah. But don't know what you do. But here's the first one, which is to connect, which is that your social relationships are the foundation of your happiness, of your well-being. They're the cornerstones of your life. And there can become times in our life when we don't pay enough attention to the people that are most important in our lives. We get taken away from our kids, our parents, our partners, our siblings, our old school friends that we've got a long history and a long way of reminiscing with. These are important people in our lives. And to remember that, you know, our connections are fundamentally about what makes us human and what makes us happy. The second one is to be active, which is that the fastest way out of a bad mood is to be physically active. It's not chocolate, coffee, alcohol, other stimulants in whatever forms they are. It's physical activity. It's getting up off the sofa. If you've ever been depressed, and there will be people in this room who've had bouts of depression, or maybe now feel it, or you've lived with somebody or you know somebody, then, you know, actually moving from the sofa or bed is really, really hard. But if you can get people up to walk, then that actually starts to move the whole organism. And the way that, you know, emotions are about a stimulus response mechanism, they are very connected to movement. You know, when we get stressed, we're feeling very tense in our body because the muscles are firing as if we should be in a fight or flight mode and we're not moving. And so we get a lot of energy stored in our body that's actually unhelpful. You know, if we're very enthusiastic, you can't help but move, you know, or dance or whatever it is we want to do when we're enthusiastic. But it's very connected to movement. And the other way works too. Movement can help us process particularly negative emotions, help us rebalance them. It doesn't have to be a sweaty exercise as for diet, but as for total health. But actually, you know, the latest evidence is that 10,000 steps a day is just really good for you, and that can be walking, and that does a lot of health outcomes. As a guy that has really avoided exercise most of my life, it's quite a relief. I now don't take the tube in London. I walk. I walk an hour through London to meetings. If a meeting's less than an hour's walk away, I'll walk there. I can do the phone. I can think on the way, and I don't have to go in the horrible tube. The third one is to take notice. Taking notice is about, I mean, people, maybe if we were messaging it now, we might be using the word mindfulness, but it's about reflection. It's about noticing what's around us. It's about being, you know, appreciating beauty. It's about reflecting, noticing the small voices and signals inside yourself that are sort of, you know, that there's something emerging for you, paying attention to those things. So taking notice is really important. Really important for actually building meaning in your life. Start to understand, you know, what's really important to you. Next one is to keep learning. Learning through the life course. That's why we put the word keep in there, because it's not just about school. In fact, some of our educational institutions are probably not very happiness inducing. You know, schools have become exam factories, very stressful, a rationing system for jobs, if you like. But actually learning, it doesn't have to be formal learning. It can be learning to cook a new dish, to fix a bike, to whatever. But learning is great for us. Stretch and challenge is great for us. Some psychologists call it flow. When we get so absorbed in something that we lose track of time. You know, musicians do it. Tennis players do it. Unfortunately, statisticians like me do it with Excel spreadsheets, you know. And I can just lose a whole afternoon, and I really quite like it. Yeah, that's sad. And the last one is to give. Is to give. That actually giving is a wonderful way for me to feel happy too. You know, evolution, that it's sort of best in some ways, that the group is really important. So if I contribute to the group, I feel good. And that helps me survive because I have a group to protect and me. And it also helps me because, you know, I'm thriving more. You know, there's studies which show that if you give people $100 in the morning, you say to half of them, go and spend it on yourself, half of them to spend it on other people. So retail therapy versus generosity therapy, that even at the end of that day, the people who gave it away were happier. A week later, they're still much happier. So generosity is really, really good for us. And if you look at those five things, notice how the first and the last, and Jodie and I deliberately ordered them in this way, are highly social. When people tell me that happiness is selfish and individualistic, I think this is a total misreading of the science. The science of it is very social. Daniel Kahneman, Nobel Prize winning economist, he's actually a psychologist, but he won it for economics. He says, happiness is almost a social emotion. We're expressing it with others and it helps us bond. So when you're building your stuff, think about how you can introduce these things into it. A lot of games, you know, video games are really good at some of these things of actually connecting people, learning, empowering them, doing stuff. Obviously, they're not quite so physically active unless you call thumbs. But, you know, but there are ways that you can start to build these things into what you do. So I just want to really finish with talking about happiness intelligence. So intelligent happiness, I think, is really important. And what I mean by that is actually let's not forget our brains as we think about happiness. We are cognitively very smart beings. Is one of the huge distinguishing things of humans, of Homo sapiens. Very good book, that, by the way, Homo sapiens. And how we've evolved to do that. But actually, our interaction between our cognition and our emotion is what becomes interesting. You know, for me, wisdom is about an emotional depth, but an intelligence in which how to express those emotions in the world. Psychologists would call this self-regulation. But if you flip the words the other way around, happiness intelligence is about data. It's about, you know, how can we do things. And what we're doing with my kind of new startup, Happiness Works, is to build responsive people metrics for organizations. And really, my opinion about happiness, and some people don't share this opinion, is that the best way to find out about how people is to ask them and listen to it. Strangely, some people think it's better if we just observe people. We observe how they do, and I do think you can create valid metrics that way. But if you want to create a process for positive change, you know, I'm a great believer in participatory processes, that we create social systems that we need to engage people with. And if you're just observing them, it feels like it's Big Brother. If you're asking them, then they're involved in this, yeah? Now, there are issues with how we design questionnaires and how we do them, but what we do at Happiness Works is that we do stuff around coloring the way that people answer. So this is just a very simple question, how happy are you at work? And we use a response scale, but we color it as well because most people are more visual than they are numeric. So, you know, give them the color codes, and we know if we're answering a green because traffic lights are so ingrained in the way we think in our culture, that we're saying something positive. So if they answer a 4, we know that's qualitatively differently than a 3 because they're going to give you a yellow if they go to the 3. So we try and use things which are more optimized for mobile, that are more friendly, that are more delightful, my business partner keeps talking about. We do lots of questions about how well you get along with people, so we look at the drivers of them, but they're not most important now. But what we try and do is we try and make the intelligence that we build for organizations actionable, because if it's just data, well, data is useful, it helps people raise awareness, but if it's actually pointing towards action. So we design dashboards for organizations to see what's going on. We draw maps of how clients, how different teams are feeling around the organization. Our product's actually called Mood Map. And we build these systems for organizations. So in practice, our largest client is Travelex. You probably know Travelex, the exchange rate booths in airports. I'm sure that not so many people aspire to work in an exchange rate booth in an airport. So they're more in Jenny's worker mode than they are in free agent mode. But they've been working with us for over a year now. We've done a full rollout to their 9,000 employees globally, 12 different languages, I think it is. We ask them every month how they are. I want to create metrics that are really close to real time. We actually, with a few clients, ask people daily how they are, but with Travelex, we're doing it monthly. And we track who leaves because they're no longer in our system. You know, we get a user list updated each month. People have left, we can see, because they're not there the next month. And actually, Travelex have shared some performance review data with them. So what we actually find is that people who were unhappy in May are much more likely to have a low performance review in July, 70% more likely. People who were unhappy in May were much more likely to have left by July, 2.07 times. And so we know, and this is an intuition everyone shares, that, you know, unhappy people are going to be, you know, less good employees, less good colleagues, they're more likely to leave, less loyal. And this data is actually starting to identify where the pockets of unhappiness in your organization are. And so therefore you can start to think about what you do about it. It's actionable intelligence. We're not prescribing exactly what they should do, but we're giving them new data. You know, large organizations will already model this, but they're modeling on objective data, and this gives them amazing new information about what's going on. So this is the global director of TravelX. I won't read the quote, you can read it behind me, but basically he's talking about how this gives them new data, helps them move away from engagement surveys, which are perhaps once every 2 years or once every year, very, very long, towards a very light way of measuring very, 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 very rapidly. You know, I know statistically we talk about variance in data. If you've got 30 questions, you've got a variance from the lowest to the highest. And if we just ask one question, we actually explain about 30-40% of that variance with one click. All of you will know about that. You know, if you can do things simpler, get a lot of the information very quickly, you're kind of on a winner because you're not putting too much burden on the respondent or the person to go through 30-40 pages of questions, whereas you can do one and you can get that. We have this in the way that people ask about customer experience. You know, how do you rate this film on a stars? You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it's amazing, you know, how you get, you know, a site which just does that, like Rotten Tomatoes or whatever it is. You know, actually, the good things float to the top. Maybe there's some error in some individual's way that they do it, or there's some very context-specific, because, you know, who you go and see a film with is massive to what your experience of it is. It's not only about the film, it can also be about the seat, it can be about whether you're ill, whether you're, you know, there's other things, there's error in that data, in a sense, for the pure film. But when you have a lot of data, the right things rise to the top. You know, TripAdvisor works on this, Airbnb, Uber, all of these things work on a very simple rating, which allows things to float to the top in the end. So just to say, really, and actually one of the reasons I accepted this, and I said it to Danny, is I want to advertise we've got some jobs. So we have two jobs going at the moment. One is head of visual design. We want someone that understands the visual universe. You probably saw from our things that they could be better. We're well aware of that. And we want someone that has an emotional feel to their work around this. So if you're interested in that, it's on our website. You can grab a card from me. I have colleagues. Will they stand up? Go on, stand up. So speak to any of those three today if you're interested in a visual design. And the other one is a full stack developer, which I don't know what that means, but presumably you do. But Sam will definitely know what that means. It means something that they do in that space over there when they build stuff. So we need a full stack developer as well. We will also have customer support one, but I don't suppose this audience is for that. So just to remind you, you know, happiness is a universal human experience. We recognize it. We broadcast our happiness. It's very contagious, actually. We're happier when we're people we love. I love Pete. It's better to go from being miserable at work to being happier at work. You should think about that, just like Jenny said before. How do we create systems that make people's work easier, more joyful for them? These five things in your own lives are really critical to connect, be active, take notice, keep learning, and give. Think about how you can introduce those into the design of your systems. I don't have an easy answer for you about that, but if you do, you'll make more joyful experiences for your users for sure, and the positive things that go with that. You can ask simple questions. I think you have to be smart about them, about how you design them. You have to go for a reading age of 12, by the way. So you don't create confusion. You can draw maps. Our mood map system does that for organizations that work with us in real time. And then to remember this, you know, that systems shape us. We are individuals, we do have free will, but systems shape us more than we realize, and you are building systems. So please build systems which improve people's experience of life. Thank you very much indeed.